I'll start with a question. How's your prayer life? How's your prayer life? Pretty easy to answer that question when no one's expecting you to call the answer out loud. Because if I've had a number of people who have been mentors for me in my Christian life, which has been a tremendous blessing, just men and women who have asked the tough questions and expected a non-fluffy answer. Because the times when I've been asked that in personal conversation, how's your prayer life? It's a question that usually leaves us stammering a little bit. Maybe it has been for you. Often we're not quite sure how to answer that. So this is what I've done. Maybe this is what you've done in the past or now. When asked, how's your prayer life? We talk about things like, when is a good time to pray? Sometimes we talk about the methods we use when we pray. I've used vague cliches like prayer warriors and prayer closets. We talk about books that we've read on prayer, like that famous one that came out a number of years ago, The Prayer of Jabez. But if we strip all the cliches away and we seek to ask the question honestly of each other and answer honestly to each other, how is your prayer life going? I mean, what are we to do with verses like 1 Thessalonians 5:17, where Paul says, pray without ceasing? How's that going? Or maybe your prayer life might more accurately reflect Nehemiah. As he was about to speak to the king, Nehemiah 2, I'm going to read it to you. Nehemiah 2, 1 to 5 says this: in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was before him, I took up the wine and gave it to the king. This is Nehemiah speaking. Now I had not been sad in his presence. And the king said to me, why is your face sad, seeing you are not sick? This is nothing but sadness of the heart. And then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my face be sad when the city, the place of my father's graves, lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire? And then the king said to me, what are you requesting? Listen to this a little bit. So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, then send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I may rebuild it. And you might be saying to me, yeah, Chris, that's me, right? I'm more of a prayer on the run type of guy. That whole pray without ceasing thing that Paul talks about, I'm working on that, but I'm more of a Nehemiah prayer, right? Which is good, but don't forget that Nehemiah also prayed like this. You've just got to go back a little bit in that story. Nehemiah 1 and 4 says, as soon as I heard these words, which is the report about Jerusalem state, I sat down and wept and mourned for days and continued fasting and praying before the Lord. And so we have to ask ourselves the question, how's our prayer life going? It's a fundamental part of the rhythm of what it means to be a follower of Jesus, right? Prayer is hard. That's been my experience. Prayer has been hard. It seems as though it should be the simplest thing in the world. But for some reason, so many of us continue to struggle with this fundamental rhythm of Christian living. So today I'm going to give you just one foundational reality of prayer. And then we're going to talk about a handful of practical aspects that I hope you'll find helpful. I mean, the subject of prayer is ginormous. And I'm going to do my very best to not repeat last week's epic. So, here's the one thing that I want to start with. Adopting a posture of prayer. Right? How do we adopt a posture of prayer? And what does that mean? Well, one thing it could mean is that we pray with folded hands, right? Maybe some people like this, or you might be more of a this person, all right? So there's a posture of prayer. That's the one we're most familiar with. That's the one that we teach our children often. You know, fold our hands, put your hands up, bow your head, close your eyes. There's a posture of prayer. What about praying with raised hands? We pray with raised hands, but that's a posture of prayer. It looks a bit Pentecostal to me, so maybe we don't do it so often in this church. What about praying while bowing down? There's a posture of prayer. We pray while bowing down, and that one looks a bit too Muslim. So I don't know if we're going to be very comfortable with that one, right? But here's the thing, I'm not talking about that type of posture. And even if I were, then that picture that you can see on the screen, that's probably the thing that we should be doing more often. Certainly if you want to go through a survey of the scriptures and look at the physical posture that people took most often while they were praying, it's that. It says, and then they fell on their faces before the Lord. They bowed low before the Lord and called out, "Oh, my Lord." All right? Or raising their hands to heaven, they cried out to God. In fact, I've done a survey of the scriptures. I don't think I can find one reference to the fact that they fold your hands and bow your head. If anything, I would say that folding our hands and bowing our heads is our effort to domesticate prayer. We've done it because we don't want our kids fidgeting. So what's the easiest way to stop fidgeting? Put your hands together, right? And don't look at things and get distracted by praying. So close your eyes. We've domesticated prayer. Maybe we need to be a little bit more of a praying people with our hands held high or our faces low to the ground before the Lord. But the thing is, I'm not talking about that top posture at all. It isn't about what I do with my hands or what position I put my body in. What does it mean to adopt a posture of prayer? And the way I want to answer that is that it is a posture of the heart. Prayer is a posture of the heart. If I could try to explain that further, I would say that prayer is an active pursuing of a relationship with God. That our heart's posture before the Lord is through prayer that I am pursuing a relationship with God. In fact, if you've picked that up, the thing that ties together these three fundamental messages that we've done, we started in the first week with a time in the Word daily. What was that about? It was about fostering a relationship with God. I want to hear from you, and I need to hear from you daily, and so I'm in the Word daily. And repentance was about a return to a relationship with God as we've wandered away. And prayer is about actively pursuing and seeking a relationship with God. This is about a relationship with God. That is the fundamentals of the Christian life. Now, to show you what I mean, I think it's about time we visit a couple of our favourite coffee cup verses. And if you're a little bit new to this church, if you're fairly recent to this church, you might not know what I mean by that. So let me explain. For those of you who are fairly new here, a coffee cup verse is a verse from the Bible that seems to inexhaustibly end up on merchandise from your favourite Christian retailer. Or if you follow enough Christian Instagram accounts, They're the favorite verses that seem to pop up over and over again with a beautiful filter on them. I think I've got a picture there of a coffee cup, Sandra, and it says something like this. I can do all things through a verse taken out of context, right? It's found in 2 Opinions chapter 3, verse 16. That's my facetious take on that. But coffee cup verses, Instagram verses, there's just a handful of select verses that we love to sort of put out there. They're the favourite ones, right? Well, let's revisit a couple of them. Here's two in particular. Here's a favourite from the old Insta. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Amen. All right? The problem is with coffee cup verses or Instagram verses is that we may be tempted just to give it a quick like and then scroll on by. But I want us to linger a while on this verse and take note of what God was saying to Solomon. You see, Solomon had just completed a multi-generational building project. A building that would be the central defining structure in Israel. A place where God would dwell amongst his people. And on the day of its consecration, after years and years of painstaking building, Solomon gathered the people and he prayed like this. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, starting from verse 12. Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands. Solomon had made a bronze platform, 5 cubits long, 5 cubits wide, 3 cubits high, and he'd set it in the court and he stood on it. And then he knelt on his knees in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands towards heaven and said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven or on earth, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart. Right, and the prayer goes on, and it calls out to God to be faithful in his relationship to his people, and it also makes promises of Israel's faithfulness to the covenant that God had made with them. And his prayer closes with these words, 2 Chronicles 6:41. And it says, And now arise, O Lord God, and go to your resting place, you and the ark of your might. Let your priests, O Lord God, be clothed with salvation, and let your saints rejoice in your goodness. O Lord God, do not turn away the face of your anointed one. Remember your steadfast love for David, his servant. And then chapter 7, verse 1 says this, As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offerings and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. And when all the people of Israel saw the fire come down and the glory of the Lord in the temple, they bowed down with their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshipped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Now Solomon had spoken. That's Solomon's prayer. But now it's God's time to speak. What would he say? You find out. Chapter 7, verse 11. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 11 says this. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord in the king's house. All that Solomon planned to do in the house of the Lord and in his own house he successfully accomplished. And then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, I've heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as the house of sacrifice. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people, who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time. Right? That's an entire sermon series, right? We could spend weeks on all of that. And my aim is not to repeat last week's marathon, so I will highlight just one pivotal observation about that entire passage. Prayer in this story is about the alignment of our heart with God's. Right? It's about pursuing God's presence. This whole interaction between Solomon and the people and God, and then how God responds, is all about pursuing God's presence. So have another look again at 2 Chronicles 7:14. Not in the Instagram version. If my people, who are called by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now, in Hebrew literature, this is called a chiastic structure. That's a big word. You don't have to worry about it. There's going to be no quiz at the end of this. But what you do need to know is that a chiasm or a chiastic structure in Hebrew literature is a type of poetry. It's a poetic device. It's a bit like, you know, when you write a limerick, it has a certain rule. Or if you write a certain type of poetry, there's certain ways that you write poetry. This is a chiastic structure. And it usually works by taking or pairing similar ideas into little couplets, into little parallel phrases that sort of fulfill or give you more information about what is being spoken about. So taken together, these couplets give you a fuller and more rounded an understanding than you could just get from one phrase alone. So I want you to have a look at the way, I've just tried to highlight them there. This is the way that a chiasm works. So the two orange phrases, see, humble themselves, and I need my glasses on to read here, but I can't read it there. Humble themselves, and then the orange phrase, and turn from their wicked ways, right? So they're the two outside parallel couplets. And the chiasm is meant to draw you to the middle. The middle phrase, or the middle couplet, is the point of the poem. So humble yourselves, turn from your wicked ways. There's these two parallel couplets there that give you an understanding of what does it mean to turn? What does it mean to repent? Well, it actually means humbling myself, right? But then that draws us to the middle, which says, and pray. What does that mean? It means to seek my face, right? So this is how prayer is operating in Solomon's interaction with God as the temple is consecrated. His prayer is saying, God, we seek your face, we seek your presence, we want relationship with you. And so we will humble ourselves and we will turn away. That's God's call to the people. God equates humbling themselves with turning from their wicked ways. And he also equates praying with seeking his face. Can you see that? So prayer here is about aligning our heart with God's and pursuing his presence above all other things. That's what prayer is about. I said we're going to look at two coffee cup verses, so here's the second. This one you will know really well. Right? In fact, the verse that I want to look at comes immediately after where Instagram stops often. All right, so this is the Instagram version, the coffee cup version. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. And then that's where Instagram scrolls. You just scroll onto the next cat reel or something, you know. Maybe you're familiar with it. The rest of it says this. Then, this is verse 12. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I'm not going to unpack all the context around that today. I've done that plenty of times. But just as a reminder, these verses, Jeremiah 29, 11, down to verse 13, all the verses that surround that even further, these verses were given through prophecy to the nation of Israel as they entered exile. This was a promise that had to carry the weight of 70 years of imprisonment. Right? It wasn't a life verse to use as a mantra to escape suffering. This was a rock solid assurance of God to sustain his people through suffering. So notice the posture of prayer that God invites his people into in the midst of their suffering, right in the middle of their suffering and their exile and their torment. This is the posture that God invites his people into. Because if it was us, if we were the ones who were in exile, if we were just ripped from our home and taken to a foreign place, be taken out of positions of privilege and been thrown into positions of lowliness, then let me tell you what my prayers would probably be filled with. Our prayers would be filled with petitions for God's deliverance, wouldn't they? God, save us, rescue us, or rescue from suffering. Or rescue so that our hardships would ease. But I want you to look what God calls his people to pray. Jeremiah 29, verse 12 again. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me. That's what God's calling as the posture of prayer. Even in the midst of their suffering, even in the midst of their exile, in the midst of their hardship, he says, seek me. Seek me. And guess what? You'll find me. When you seek me, you'll find me. I'm there. I'm not distant from your suffering. I'm not distant from your hardship. I'm in the midst of it with you. When you seek me, when your eyes come to me and not your hardship, not your desire for freedom, not your desire for liberty, not your desire for the ease of your difficulties. He says, when you seek me, then you'll find me when you seek me with all your heart. So how often is our prayer life dominated by our own concerns? Right? I have a prayer list. You might too. And I put things on my prayer list for specific things. I categorize my prayer lists. In fact, I've got prayer lists for family. I've got prayer lists for, you know, this church. I've got prayer lists for other things that I know about and I'm involved in. I've got prayer lists and they're good. I'm not saying don't have a prayer list. But I was challenged as I read this, is where on my prayer list is seek God's face? Is it there? Or is it just about me? Is it just about my concerns? My perspectives. God is inviting us to pursue him in our prayer life. That's what he wants us to do. Because of Jesus Christ, regardless of the circumstances and level of comfort that you may experience in your lifetime, you have, because of Christ, a future and a hope. You have access to the very presence of God. You can call out to Jesus and he will hear you. If you seek him, you will find him. All right. So that's That's prayer as a position of the heart. What I want to do is just do some practical things now for a moment. So prayer now as a practice of the heart. So it's all fine and good to say, how's your prayer life? And you can talk about vague things about even, well, you know, I'm seeking God and things like that. But you've actually got to, at some point in time, pray, right? It's a bit like talking about evangelism. We can talk all about evangelism, but never actually do it. We can talk all about prayer, but never actually do it. So here's some practical things that I hope are going to help you in your prayer life. But unless we approach prayer as primarily about pursuing relationship with God, let me tell you that all the techniques in the world will simply be a useless pursuit of empty religious discipline. If you can say, oh, I've prayed for X amount of minutes or X amount of hours, and I've started bowing down, or I've done, you can do all sorts of things, but unless you are pursuing relationship, it's pointless. So here's a few things that I want you to take in mind. The first one is this. Cultivate confidence in your prayer life. Cultivate confidence in your prayer life, but be wary of arrogance in your prayer life. There's a beautiful verse in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Hebrews 4 and verse 16 says this. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. All right. I want you to take from that you and I in Christ have one of the most privileged positions known to any human being. A privileged position that up until Jesus came as our intermediate, as the one who stood in the gap, as Jesus came and dealt with sin, no human being had this privilege, and you and I in Christ today have this privilege. You and I can walk boldly into the throne room of God. You can approach the unapproachable one, the one who stands. In fact, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 15, I don't know if I've got it on the screen, but just listen to it. 1 Timothy 6, verse 15, this is how God is described. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in inapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And you can walk into that. Hebrews says, with confidence, approach the throne of grace because of who Jesus is. But that's the point. That's why I say, be confident in your prayer life. In your prayer life, call out to God. Don't feel that you are so distant from him that you can't ask him, that you can't seek him. He desires and longs for you to walk into his presence. And so develop confidence, but it's not arrogance. It's not like, well, you know, I'm a pretty good Christian. I've sort of got things down pat, and now surely God will listen to me because I've been doing all these wonderful things. It's not about you. And it's all about Christ. And you're there in his shadow, as it were, wrapped up in him. And as he walks into the presence of God, you can walk into the presence of God. So develop confidence. Because of Christ, we have unparalleled access to the Holy of Holies. All right? You aren't just tolerated in the courts of heaven. That might be hard for you to get your head around sometimes. But you aren't just tolerated in the courts of heaven. You are invited and welcomed as a son or as a daughter, and so draw near with confidence. Second practical thing I want you to take away from this. Establish rhythms of regular prayer. Establish rhythms of regular prayer. Right, I know you can pray anytime. You can. You can just pray anytime. Paul says, remember, we should pray unceasingly. But I want to commend to you the discipline of a rhythm of regular prayer. Psalm 5, just the first three verses. Psalm 5. This is what the psalmist says. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my groaning. Give attention to the sound of my cry, my King and my God, for to you do I pray. O Lord, in the morning you hear my voice. In the morning I prepare a sacrifice for you and watch. I want to say to you this morning, it is not legalistic to set aside a dedicated, regular time to pray each day. Set a reminder in your phone if you have to. Right? If you're a person that just gets easily distracted and you have a so-called smartphone, and if you're not sure how to do it, then get somebody to help you. How do I set a reminder? How do I set up a regular alarm? How do I set something to say, Chris, you stupid heads, time to start praying, right? I need that. But set it. And I know that you can redeem the kind of the margins of your life. When you're driving to an appointment or you're in between things, you can discipline your time to sort of say, oh, I'm going to use this time to pray for it. Do that. Like, do that all day round if you can. But if prayer is only relegated to the margins of your day, then guess what? Prayer will only ever be experienced in the margins of your life. Set aside dedicated time for prayer. And I'm going to commend to you the discipline of creating space in your day by blocking out a regular time each morning, if you can. I don't think the psalmist is saying that the only time God hears prayers is when you do it in the morning. But what a great time of the day. As the day is set before you, the psalmist says, I'm going to pray, I'm going to call out to you, I'm going to set my altar, I'm going to set up my sacrifice, and I'm going to watch. It's the idea of coming before the Lord at the outset of your day and laying before Him the ways that you desire to seek Him and the petitions of your heart. And then in watchfulness over the day, watching, how is God going to respond? How will He answer? And then the next morning, set up the altar again. Lay out the sacrifice of your prayer and watch again. So set up a regular rhythm. All right, next thing. And I think the last thing. Jesus asks us to work out your prayer life in private. Work out your prayer life in private in order to be a blessing in public. So Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. Jesus is teaching on prayer. He says this, when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. No one likes a hypocrite, do they? When you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by others. Can you see what their prayer life was dominated by? Themselves. Right? Their prayer life was dominated by other people's opinions of them. Their prayer life was dominated by everything else apart from what it should be, which is seeking the face of God. So Jesus says, truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. If they want the praise of man, then more than likely they've received the praise of man and they've got their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard by their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. And then pray like this, and He gives that famous example of the Lord's Prayer. Let me just quickly say to you, you don't need fancy words to pray. If one of the things that's holding you back in your prayer life is sort of that self-conscious, I don't know what to pray. I don't know all the right words to say. You don't need fancy words to pray. In fact, Jesus makes it very clear, you don't even need many words to pray. You certainly don't need an audience to pray. Jesus isn't saying that the only way to pray is privately. There are a bunch of New Testament passages we could go to this morning on prayer that talk about being able to add your amen to other people's prayer. How would you be able to do that if we only ever prayed in a private place, right? But the danger with public prayer is that we can begin to subtly make it about us and not about God. One of the things we love to do almost every week is have a time of open sharing where we've got the microphone here and there's testimonies like we've done this morning, or people have prayed. There's a danger about public prayer where we feel like it draws attention to us. And that's not what it's there for. So work out your prayer life in private so that you can begin to be a blessing to other people in public and they can say, yeah, amen, I add my... Do you realize that what amen means, right? It's not like a full stop at the end of a prayer. Amen is actually meant for other people to say, not you, when you're praying. Amen means, I agree. So when somebody gets up here to pray and you're listening to them pray and you want to join your prayer life to them, call out, amen. I add my agreement to your prayer, brother. I add my agreement to your prayer, my sister. All right? That's what amen means. Prayer has often been used as a tool for the superficially religious, right, and the self-proclaimed pious as a way of elevating their status around those amongst the people that they're praying amongst, right? If I pray beautifully with fancy words and long, then people must think that I'm going to be particularly a spiritual person. And Jesus says, don't do that. Don't do that. Spend focused time with God in private, where you won't be distracted and tempted by that inner Pharisee, right? Invest in your relationship with God. Grow in your ability to speak with Him in simple and sincere ways. Find ways to align your words with His heart. And from this place in private, this place of integrity within your prayer life, you'll often find that it starts to overflow into the public spaces. All right, here's a really simple thing. You probably know this. ACTS. Have you ever heard the acronym ACTS, A-C-T-S? There's lots of different methods out there for prayer life, but I want to leave you with just one really simple one. ACTS is a simple way to try and help remember a pattern for your prayer life. It starts with adoration. So tell God what you love about Him. So in your private prayer life, or even in your public prayer life, it's a great little model to follow. Adoration, start there, which just simply means tell God what you love about Him. Not what He's done, but who He is, right? It's like when you have the joy of a happy marriage. It's a nice thing to say to your wife, I really appreciate the fact that you washed my clothes and folded them for me and put them on the bed. I really enjoyed that. One of the dangers of saying that to her continuously is that she may start to think that the only reason that you love her is because she washes your clothes. All right? You may be grateful for the things that she does for you, but it's a very good thing to tell her quite regularly about the things that you love about her, not just what she does. All right, there's a little tip for you men that I'm trying to work out in my own life as well. How much more important that we do that with God? Get to know who He is and tell Him about the things that you love about Him, about His character, about what He's like. God, I love this about You. All right, that's adoration. So adoration, acts. C, confession. All right? Verbalize to God what He already knows. It's a powerful way of aligning your heart in sincerity with God's. It's to simply come before Him and say, God, I know that You know this, but I want to be honest with You. I really stumbled today. I really lost my way with that. I lost my temper when I had that conversation. I know You know that, God. But tell Him, right? That's a good way to develop relationship. So adoration, confession, thanksgiving. Now is the time to say to God, this is what I love that You've done. All right? Now thank God for what He is doing in your life. God, thank You for the way that You did whatever it is, right? So adoration, confession, thanksgiving. The last one is an old word, supplication. It's just an old word which means request. All right? So too often we get this list back to front. Our prayer life begins with, oh God, I've got a big list of things that I need you to do for me, right? Well, let's start pushing that list to the back. Let's start with, God, this is who you are, and I think you're amazing. And this is the way that I've lost my way, and I just want to be honest with you, confession. And thank you so much for the way that you've been patient with me, the way that you've blessed me, and you're thanking God. And now bring your requests to God. This is where we ask God to act on our behalf in this world in ways that we know we can't. And that may be requests for yourself. It quite often be requests for other people and for their needs. That's a great alignment to God's heart as well. But that's a simple acts, A-C-T-S, is a simple way that you can start to pattern your prayer life. I'm done. 3 minutes to 11. That's got to be a record. It's not all I have to say about that subject, but it will be for today. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are beautiful. We see you and acknowledge you today as the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who does dwell in inapproachable light. You are holy and righteous. You are consistent. You are merciful. And we acknowledge that in 100 different ways, in 1,000 different ways, we fall short of your glory when we operate in our own strength, in our own flesh. But we thank you that amongst all the great things that you have ever done, you have given your life for a sinner like me. That you have made a way for me to know the Father, to walk with boldness into his throne room, to cry out, Abba, Father, to know that you hear the requests of our heart, that the big things that are on our mind and even the smallest things you are aware of, and you desire us to leave them at your feet. And so, Lord, help us, we pray. Help us to be a praying people who seek your face, that we be a church marked by prayer, so that we would know you and that others would know you. And so we ask for your help. Holy Spirit, strengthen us for this task, we pray. Amen.